The helicopter skimmed over the exclusion zone, the abandoned houses below hinting at the devastation. The only sound was the thump of the rotor blades echoing across the still night. It was a nearly impossible mission. Through the darkness, the largest loomed up ahead. Chernobyl. The pilot tightened his grip on the controls just as the radiation levels in his dosimeter began to spike into the red. On today's episode of the Infographic Show, we're telling the story of the pilots who flew into the Chernobyl core. On April 26, 1986, the Chernobyl power plant catastrophically failed, shooting plumes of fire and deadly radiation into the night sky. The event sent shockwaves throughout the world. While some mourned from afar, others were called into action. The disaster would not go away on its own. People were needed on the ground. People who could clean up the mess, contain it, and figure out exactly what had gone wrong. People who would put their very lives at risk. Mykola Melnyk was born in 1953 near Kyiv, Ukraine. He was an accomplished helicopter pilot working as a test pilot for the Kamov Helicopter Design Bureau, until one day the Soviet Union called him to help out with the cleanup project. See, the Soviet Union desperately needed pilots. Ground crews couldn't even go near the reactor itself in the weeks following the disaster. Close to the reactor core, radiation levels hit 300 sieverts per hour, with levels around 200 sieverts per hour around the building itself. The safe dose for radiation workers? 20 millisieverts per year. It's even lower for the general public at 1 millisievert per year. According to experts of the time, this level of radiation would release a lethal dose for humans in just 1 minute. In the short term, even a radiation level of just 10 sieverts is fatal within a few weeks. So Chernobyl was a real problem for getting people in and out alive. But helicopters? Helicopters only needed to hover around the reactor site for a few seconds, exposing the pilot to significantly lower levels of radiation. While he would end up performing many missions for his government, Melnyk was the man in charge of one of the most important operations of all, Operation Needle. In mid-June, Melnyk's commanders asked him to do a training exercise in Moscow, one that seemed a bit random to him. Using his helicopter, he was supposed to drop a giant needle-like probe into a very precise spot, a mission that was deemed incredibly difficult, requiring coordination, expert flying skills, and superhuman precision. But Melnyk had been picked precisely because of his superior precision skills, something that earned him the nickname the Jeweler. And that day in Moscow, Melnyk succeeded, to the surprise of almost everyone. Observers were so excited they broke out into applause when Melnyk successfully executed the maneuver. But the famously transparent Soviet Union still wasn't going to inform the pilot about his mission. After all, they hadn't even informed the public or even other scientific communities and governments about what was going on. They only admitted that there had been an incident at all after the Finnish and Swedish governments called up to ask why there was suddenly a whole lot of radiation leaking into their airspace. And even then, the USSR assured those other countries that the Chernobyl incident was under control, which must have been news to everyone actually working on cleaning up the site. After completing a difficult training exercise, Melnyk heard of his upcoming mission while he was on his way to the Borispol airport in Kyiv. According to Melnyk himself, his reaction was, "Woe is my youth." Understandable since he was only 32 years old at the time of the mission, but he chose to put his life on the line for his country and its people. So on June 19, 1986 at 9 a.m., Melnyk found himself flying toward the Chernobyl reactor core on a deadly serious mission. Sitting in a Kamov coaxial rotor helicopter, Melnyk was dragging along a 59-foot radiation probe. The point of Melnyk's mission was to drop this heavy cylindrical weight into a tiny circular opening above the reactor. The opening was about 3.3 feet across. That doesn't sound too small until you're trying to drop a probe nearly the same width from 1,300 feet up. Then it is tiny. Smaller, lighter probe operations had been suggested and immediately thrown out. Scientists realized that most materials would immediately melt in the temperatures formed by the reactor core. In the days following the Chernobyl explosion, the reactor would continue to burn at around 4,700 degrees Fahrenheit. That's about half as hot as the surface of the sun. The heavy needle that Melnyk was dragging had been built with the most effective casing possible for surviving the interior of the reactor. Because of the intense heat in the updrafts and the load it was carrying, the helicopter couldn't get too close to the reactor. It would have to pass over at a height of more than the whole Empire State Building above the opening while executing an incredibly difficult maneuver. Yet another complication? The opening wasn't really open. Scientists knew that a crust would have formed on it, a crust that the probe would have to break through in order to accomplish its task, which is why it had to not only be long, but also heavy. So absolutely no pressure on Melnyk. the needle's probe was covered in sensors that would feed scientists information on temperatures, gamma radiation, and neutron flux within the failed reactor. Even after a month, there was a strange glow coming from the reactor, and scientists had no idea what was going on, or what they needed to do to contain further damage, making this mission absolutely critical. Melnick started his flight well outside of the inner exclusion zone. Makeshift bases had been set up far away from the reactor so people could plan cleanup operations outside the 18.6-mile exclusion zone. As he approached, Melnick was aware that almost everything was working against him and the mission. First off, hermetically sealed Mi-24 helicopters had taken radiation readings above the reactor. They were the only ones that could hang around the power plant for that long, as they had special lead coatings, filters, and systems for maintaining air quality. Melnick knew that once he got directly above the reactor, even at 1,300 feet, he was going to be blasted by radiation, around 3,000 Rontgens per hour, or 26 sieverts per hour. According to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, just 400 to 450 Rontgens, or about 4 to 4.5 sieverts, delivered over a few hours is enough to kill roughly 50% of the people exposed within 30 days. So 3,000 Rontgens was a real problem. Worse yet, because of the wind currents and other anomalies, certain spots around the reactor saw radiation levels of up to 20,000 Rontgens per hour. So, Melnick was flying over the eerily abandoned villages of the area, looking at the reactor core ahead, and praying. And as he got closer and closer to the core, his palms were sweating as he got ready to release the massive metal needle into the reactor core. A few hundred feet away, he ran into another problem. The high temperatures inside of the reactor caused severe turbulence. The heat and instability inside of the superheated air kept pushing out through the core's opening at the top. This created intense updrafts that started shaking Melnick's helicopter. Relying on a feed from the camera at the end of the metal needle, Melnick attempted to make the drop anyway. He released the needle, and he heard a clattering. His heart sank. The needle had missed its mark. Reports differ as to whether the frozen crust above the reactor core was hit at the wrong angle, or reinforced debris caused the needle to bounce off instead of dropping inside. Whatever it was, it meant one thing: Melnick would have to fly over the core and its intensely lethal radiation again. He turned his helicopter to make another pass. At this point, he was hoping his sweaty hands were due to his nerves and not radiation sickness. He checked the camera feed and he couldn't believe it. The first failed drop had damaged the camera. Melnick was flying blind. He would have to rely on the three operational crew on board to confirm that he could drop the needle. But the radiation that they were being exposed to wasn't just affecting them, it could seriously affect the helicopter they were flying in. The Chernobyl explosion released a huge burst of gamma radiation into the atmosphere, along with some alpha and beta radiation. The gamma radiation was especially problematic, as it penetrates both structural and electrical components of the aircraft. The structural issues would show up over time. Degradation of the rotor blades, for example, and this would make the helicopters useless in the long run. Which is why the Air Force Ministry in Belarus eventually announced that every helicopter used for the Chernobyl cleanup was destroyed and buried. Radiation damage to the engines and lower fuselages made them unfit for flying. But Melnick's concern was damage to the electronics. This could be more severe, more direct, and more deadly. Gamma rays disrupt crystalline structure, meaning that all the zeros and the ones in a digital circuit could be flipped by gamma radiation, corrupting all the data. Even more problematic, for a helicopter at the time at least, gamma rays ionize and therefore damage semiconductors. And in helicopters, semiconductors are everywhere, from navigation to radios to flight control systems to the actual displays in the cockpit. Melnick really couldn't afford to lose even one of those systems. As Melnick approached, once again dropping the needle toward the reactor, another miss. His hope and that of the crews was rapidly disappearing. Melnick made yet another turn for a third attempt. At the same time, he couldn't escape a nagging thought. He and his crew had been in the heavily irradiated air for almost 30 minutes. The helicopter provided some protection, but not a lot. Instead of flying the special Mi-26S, scientifically developed for Chernobyl cleanup, a helicopter that could carry heavy loads while being equipped with protective screens and filters, Melnick was flying a Kamov. Why? No one is 100% sure. Some say the Kamov's unique rotor design made it better suited for a mission that required this insane level of precision. The crew were taking all the precautions they had been advised to take, carrying personal dosimeters, changing clothes after each flight, eating vitamin-rich meals, even using creams and medicine that their superiors gave to them to increase their resistance to radiation. But even they knew most of those precautions were for show and largely ineffective. Unfortunately, the men would have no idea how much radiation they had taken on until much later. And it's unclear if they even took the one precaution that could have actually protected them – iodine pills. One of the isotopes released during the Chernobyl disaster was iodine-131, which can lead to thyroid cancer. The cases of thyroid cancer in Ukrainian children after Chernobyl, though rare to begin with, increased around 200%. The problem? Your body recognizes the radioactive iodine as regular iodine and it stores it in your thyroid. Iodine pills flood your system with safe iodine so your body won't be able to absorb the radioactive kind. Otherwise, that radioactive iodine sits in your thyroid steadily firing off radiation and damaging the DNA the whole time it's in there. But the distribution to iodine pills at the first responders at Chernobyl was completely haphazard and disorganized. So much so that we still have little idea of who actually got them and when. They are only really effective when given within 2 or a maximum of 8 hours after exposure. If Melnik was given iodine pills on his third day in Chernobyl, they might as well have been placebos. Knowing that he has almost no real protection for himself or his helicopter, Melnik lined up the core in his sights, determined to finally make this drop. It was do or die. Through dust and debris, he aimed directly for the core. The radioactive dust, melted debris, and cleanup equipment everywhere made the approach a minefield. In fact, on October 2, 1986, an Mi-8 helicopter dropping sand and lead on the reactor to contain the radioactivity and damage crashed after flying too close to a crane in the area. A sudden gust spun the crane, and with the sun in his eyes and visibility already bad, the pilot didn't see the crane arm swinging toward him until it was too late. The helicopter's rotor blades hit a chain, bringing the entire thing crashing down. This incident happened months after Melnik's mission. But as an experienced aviator, he already understood how dangerous the area was. Flying within just dozens of feet of the reactor, he worked to drop the metal cylinder as straight as possible, hoping that it would punch through the crust. The needle fell. Melnik held his breath, and then he heard it break through. It rapidly fell, with more than two-thirds of it embedding into the building. Relieved at least for the moment, Melnik turned the helicopter and flew away. But his mission wasn't over. He still had to drop a 650 to 985-foot cable on the correct side of the building. Ground crews could then pull it up into a safe room and attach it to their equipment. Like almost everything else in this mission, though, whether due to horrible luck, radiation interference, or horrible environmental conditions, the drop went wrong. The lock failed and the cable landed in the wrong spot. The situation was only salvaged because a team of USSR scientists were walking through the building just minutes later and they saw the cable dangling outside of a window. Without a second thought, Vyacheslav Pismeny, a doctor of physics, broke the glass to get the cable, while another man behind him helped pull it into the building. That other man was Yevgeny Velikov, the former vice president of the USSR Academy of Sciences. Chernobyl was truly an all-hands-on-deck kind of moment. Everyone just put on whatever hat was violently thrown at them at the moment. Melnik and his crew arrived back at the base. They'd been in the air for 36 minutes. Later on, doctors would find that Melnik had been exposed to radiation levels at least 10 times above the permitted level. Between May 20, 1986 and September 9, 1986, Melnik would complete 46 different sorties with 52 hours of flight time in the area. For his troubles, he received the Soviet Union's highest honor, the title of the Hero of the Soviet Union. Years later, the International Federation of Helicopter Pilots also honored him and his whole team, as well as the other pilots involved in the multi-month Chernobyl cleanup. They admiringly called them those crazy Russians. Though the probe he dropped provided a lot of useful information to scientists, it was sending temperature readings that didn't make any sense. Years later, people would discover that the probe had landed not in the reactor pit, but in the spent fuel pool. And the honors would do little to prevent the inevitable fallout from his mission. None of Melnik's three crew members would make it to 50 years old. One died at 39, another at 40, and the third at 48. Melnik himself survived to the age of 59, but not without problems. In 1994, he needed two separate surgeries for complications caused by his radiation exposure. His doctors advised him to cut out drinking and smoking to give himself the best chance of a long life. Melnik ignored them because, as he later told a reporter, "I decided I would live the way I like, not limiting myself in anything." And after what he had been through, who could blame him? He eventually died in 2013 in Spain, where he spent the last years of his life as a test pilot and a trainer for local pilots. Now go check out Chernobyl Nuclear Explosion Disaster Explained Hour by Hour to see how it all went down, or click on this video instead.